Thank you very much, Teo, for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to be here in Stony Brook. And what I would like to talk about today is our joint work. Anton Zosimov. And most of what I'm going to talk about can be found in archive. In the following two papers, 1705-01603 and 2206-1434. So what I would like to talk about is several ramifications of Arnold's approach to fluid dynamics. So that was a groundbreaking work in the 1960s that Arnold came out with a new kind of view on fluid dynamics, namely the Euler equation that was known already by for 250 years can be regarded as some object of differential geometry. So let me give this Arnold setting in a nutshell, and then I'll explain what can be done with this. So, so first, Arnold setting of fluid dynamics. So suppose that we have some manifold. Let's assume, for instance, a compact manifold M. I will assume that it is actually a Riemannian manifold. Let's say compact, or it could have boundary. I also assume that we have a volume form on this manifold. It could be, for instance, Riemannian volume form, but not necessarily. And we think of this as filled with the fluid. We describe this fluid by its velocity field. So every point is moving with some velocity, and altogether, this will be velocity field of the fluid. Now, the Euler equation itself describes how this velocity field evolves in time. So the Euler equation is the following equation. So I'll give it its explicit form. And it is as follows. So V is a function on the manifold, but it also depends on time. So the time derivative of V plus the covariant derivative of V along itself, this is defined because it is a Riemannian manifold, is equal to minus gradient of a function, which is called a pressure function. And this pressure function is defined uniquely by the second condition. We assume that the fluid which is filling this manifold is volume preserving. So the corresponding velocity field must be divergence free with respect to the measure. So divergence of the velocity is equal to zero every way on M. If manifold has boundary, then we also assume that V is tangent to the boundary. Now, it looks somewhat complicated, but we'll see later on what can be done with this equation. Now, Arnold's observation, so it's 1966, is that it turns out that the Euler equation can be regarded as the equation of a geodesic flow. So it is the geodesic equation on the group of volume preserving diffeomorphisms of the manifold M. So G will be the diffeomorphisms of the manifold M, which preserve the volume element. So let's see. mu will be the volume form. So as I mentioned, it could be related to Riemannian volume, not necessarily. Of course, the covariant derivative in that case will be with respect to the metric, while divergence free condition will be with respect to the volume form. Now, we consider this group. It is, of course, an infinitesimal object. And we put on this group a Riemannian structure. So in order to consider the geodesic equation on that group. So this Riemannian structure is given by the, so this is, as I said, volume preserving diffeomorphisms of M with respect to the right invariant L2 metric. On G, which is that the identity is given by the L2 energy of the velocity field. So the energy of the velocity is 1/2 of the integral over M of the square of V integrated against the measure form. So now let me comment on this formulation. So as a matter of fact, it is a much more general statement than it is written here. Namely, just start with an arbitrary Lie group. So this will be a Lie group. In that particular case, this is a group of volume preserving diffeomorphisms, but not necessarily. We could consider, and Arnold considered in his paper, the group of three-dimensional rotations. SO3, so this is just any group, any Lie group. I take its identity element and consider the corresponding tangent space at the identity. So this will be the corresponding Lie algebra. In that case, it will be the Lie algebra of divergence-free vector fields, so satisfying this condition. Now, on this Lie algebra, this is a vector space, I will put some inner product. So this is, it will be given by this quadratic form, the energy. So I know how to measure the length of every vector. So this will be the unit ball, for instance, with respect to that inner product. Now, by means of right translations, I will move this quadratic form at any other tangent space. So I know how to measure vectors here and here, and so on. So by means of right translation, it means that this is a right invariant metric. So once I have a metric, it is a weak metric in the sense that the topology is different from L2, but doesn't matter. I can consider a geodesic on this group. So for instance, given a velocity vector, let's say V, I will look at the geodesic on this group. So this will be with this velocity vector starting at the identity of the group. Now we will do the following. At any moment of time, I take the corresponding velocity vector at that moment t and pull this back to the identity again by using the right translations. So this way, in principle, I will not get the original vector. I would if it were a one-parameter subgroup. And it would be the case if the metric were bi-invariant. But it is just one-sided invariant metric, so in principle it will be some other vector. So by kind of tracing the corresponding velocity here, I will be getting some evolution of the velocity vector. So there will be some equation that the time derivative of V will be whatever, some nonlinear operation that I don't write explicitly related to the group and the metric. So this is the energy metric. Now the claim is that this very equation is described, is exactly the Euler equation if I just put this L2 and G as I mentioned over there. But as a matter of fact, so a quick remark, that we have two ingredients here. One ingredient is the group itself, and the other ingredient is this metric which I put on the group. So if I just change this pair, it turns out that it leads to other, so other pairs give other equations of mathematical physics. So for instance, they give the Euler top in dimension 3 or higher. It gives Kirchhoff equations for the motion of a rigid body in a fluid. If I move to infinite dimensions, we will obtain Bürger's equation for the Virasoro group, which is a group of, for instance, different films of the circle extended by one extra dimension. We'll get Kartewiak de Vries equation for L2 metric. If I change metric, if it is H1, it will become Asser-Holm equation. H1 dot will give us Hunter-Saxton equation. Moreover, if I kind of double this group, we have diffeomorphisms and yet another vector field. It turns out that it describes magneto-hydrodynamics equation and so on. So there are many, many equations that actually fit into this Arnold's framework. Okay, now let's kind of step aside from this point of view. And now I would like to consider a different problem, namely the description of vertex sheets in fluid dynamics. So what are they? So in general, vertex sheets are just they're given by vector fields which exhibit jumps in the velocity. So the classical example is that you have a flow past the airplane wing, so and then it turns out that there will be the hypersurface behind this wind, and the flow above will be much faster than the flow below. So there is a clear discontinuity in the velocity field along this hypersurface. In the idealized setting that I would like to consider, I'll have again a compact manifold M, and the velocity field inside this manifold. Again, I assume that this velocity field is divergence free, but there exists a hypersurface of discontinuity. So there exists a vector field here and a vector field on the other side. Let me call them V plus and V minus. And the hypersurface, let me call this gamma. And the setting that I will consider is as follows. So I assume that on both halves of this, on both sides of the hypersurface, it is again a divergence reactor field. Often, even though it's not necessary, but in what I would like to say right now, this field is assumed to be a gradient field. So the each of these vector fields V plus minus will be equal to gradient of a function, which in principle could be different on both sides. And there exists the discontinuity along gamma, but discontinuity of a special kind. We would like the normal component of both vector fields V plus and V minus to be the same, so that there would be no kind of gap in the next moment when this hypersurface moves. But the tangential component can be different. So it means that if I subtract this, the normal components is the same for them, so this is tangent to gamma. So this is the condition that indeed the vertex sheet exists and it kind of moves in time. Okay, so in some sense, I could say that the curl of such a field is kind of delta type function on gamma. So it is, since it is a gradient field, and divergence is equal to zero, so that the curl is zero here and here, but it is kind of infinite along the hypersurface. So that's kind of intuitive way of thinking about the vertex sheet. Now, I would like to introduce, just like similarly to what I did here, we looked at the group of volume-preserving diffeomorphisms. In this setting, I would like to consider the space of all vertex sheets. So in this case, it means that I consider kind of all hypersurfaces nearby. So let me call this vertex sheet. So in M, this will be the space of. So what do I mean by that? It means that I am looking at hypersurfaces. They have the same topological nature, so I would like to consider kind of a neighborhood of a given hypersurface. But since the field is divergence, since the field is divergence free, or fluid is volume preserving, if it bounds some domain, that it must, of course, the volume inside this domain must be conserved. So it means that hypersurfaces which are bounding the same volume. So some kind of total mass condition, so to say, on these hypersurfaces. Now, what about the? So this is an infinite dimensional space of all such hypersurfaces. I would like to now describe a tangent vector to this space. So what does that mean? That infinitesimal deformation of this. It means that I can now move this surface by a normal field. So let me call this field U. So now the tangent vector to at a point to vertex on the space of vertex sheets will be a vector field which is attached at gamma. And it is orthogonal to gamma, such a vector field. Okay, so a section of the normal bundle, if you wish. But of course, it so that the integral is equal to zero because we have to have the conservation of the volume as before. Okay, now I have a vector. Now I would like to put a metric on this space. So I would like to associate some number to any such tangent vector. So the metric on Vs is given in the most natural way. Namely, so if I take this square of this vector field, what number do I associate to that? The following number. I will look at a smooth vector field in the whole of M, in the whole of the manifold M, which does the job, which actually arranges exactly this infinitesimal motion of the surface gamma. So I'm kind of, if you wish, expanding this U to a smooth vector field V, take the corresponding L2 norm of this large vector field on the whole of M, and then take infinium of all possible vector fields which actually have this normal component on gamma. So let me just write this down. So this is infinium of the integral of V times V over M, such that the divergence of this V is zero. And moreover, the normal component of such a vector field V on the whole manifold M on gamma, so this is the component of the times then on gamma is exactly U.
Some previously suggested that U should be a jump of some between two vector fields, and now it is just restriction of some smooth global smooth vector field.
Right. I said that V plus and V minus have the same normal component. So this will be the normal component. Right? So they have the jump only in the tangent space, but not in the normal direction. And this is exactly the normal direction which is common for both of them. Now I just extend this normal component to the whole vector field, I don't even care if there exists a tangential component. All I have to do is just, I would like to make sure that it has the same projection to the normal. And then I take infinum over all such fields.
Gamma is co-dimension one?
Or? Co-dimension one, yeah, yeah. It's hypersurface. Yeah. Hypersurfaces, co-dimension one. Okay. So this is a metric. Why did I introduce this metric? It turns out that there exists the following theorem due to Felix Otte and his student Loschke. I will deliberately formulate it just above this. Theorem, so it's and it is in 2012, that if you look at the geodesics on the space of all vertex sheets with respect to that metric, then it turns out that that's exactly what describes evolution of vertex sheets in fluid dynamical equations. So so these are motions of vertex sheets in potential flows, as I mentioned there. In compressible fluid. And now a natural question is, what is the relation of these two approaches? So it's clear that in both of them we have geodesic motion, but there exists no clear group structure at all when we have the space of hypersurfaces. I mean, what does it mean? I mean, what kind of invariance of the metric is there? Kind of how to kind of marry together these two approaches? So it's so how to unify the two approaches? And for this, I will again start the third topic. Kind of let's kind of keep this question in mind. But now I would like to have yet one more point of view on Arnold's picture. It will be now, in some sense, not intrinsic geometry as it was here. So here we started with a quadratic form and then extended it to the whole group of all imprisoned Giffard fields. Now I would like to think about this as an exterior geometry. Namely, I would like to think of this group of all imprisoned Giffard fields as sitting inside the much bigger group of all diffeomorphisms as a submanifold. And then kind of what can be said by looking at this from above. And it turns out that that point of view relates all this fluid dynamics to yet one more domain of study, and this is optimal mass transport. So geometry of all diffeomorphisms, the group of all diffeomorphisms of the manifold M, and what sometimes is called Otte's calculus. Okay. Imagine the group of all diffeomorphisms of M. So this will be this group. So all smooth diffeomorphisms. So in all my lecture today, I assume that everything is infinitely smooth and I do not care about analysis, even though one can actually put it there by considering Sobolev spaces, but I will concentrate on the geometry of this picture only. Now, I will also consider the space of all densities on M. So in other words, the space of all volume forms. So I'm thinking of nu. So nu will be a volume form on M, meaning that nu is everywhere positive, and also it is normalized by the condition that the total mass is equal to 1. So one can think of this as probability densities, for instance. So mu, which was originally here, is just a reference density. It is one point in this space, mu. But there are many more, right? Just all possible volume forms that are everywhere then. Now, the group of mu-preserving diffeomorphisms is sitting here as a subgroup. And I will think of this as just a fiber. So this will be diffeomorphisms preserving mu. So that there is a natural projection from diffeomorphisms, they act on densities. Now I take any other volume form, nu, with the same total mass. The fiber over nu will not be the subgroup of diffeomorphisms preserving nu, just because the identity, of course, is just sitting here. And this is a fibration. What it, so the fiber over nu consists of all diffeomorphisms of M such that they move the density mu, the reference one, to nu. And of course, I can multiply on the right by mu preserving diffeomorphism. So it's indeed a fibration, or it's rather, you can think of this as a space of right cassettes. So of course, it is a submersion just because of the Moser theorem. One can move any volume to any other volume, provided that they have the same total mass. Okay, now, so this is the projection, is the fiber isomorphic to volume-preserving diffeomorphisms. Now, I would like to put some metric here. So the metric will be as follows. It will be an L2-type metric on this whole group of all diffeomorphisms. And it is given by the following formula. So suppose that I have a path. It will be probably easier to describe it this way. Suppose that I have a path which is a diffeomorphism G, which depends on time, on the parameter on this path. Then the energy of the corresponding, so suppose that I have a velocity vector, dtg, it's just a velocity, and I would like to assign a number to this path, and in some sense it will be the most natural object, namely it will be one half of the integral of just the L2 square of this vector field. But remember, of course, when I take this time derivative, I'm at the point G itself. So it means that this is, of course, depends on X, and this is taking, the inner product is taking at the point G of X. And then I integrate with respect to the reference density. Of course, if I rewrite this by means of the standard velocity field at the identity, I could change variables here, and it will be the integral of V cross V, but there I have to put the action, the pullback of the measure, mu, here. So this is the metric that I consider. Notice that this metric is not right invariant anymore. It is right invariant if if g star of mu is mu again. So for volume preserving diffeomorphism, it is right invariant. But if we write, if we act by all diffeomorphism, it is not. However, the advantage of this metric is that it is flat for a flat M. Indeed, what we actually are dealing with here, suppose that we have just Rn for M, even though it's not compact, but doesn't matter. I mean, or you can think of a torus, just a flat manifold. Then a diffeomorphism is just a vector function. You have a point, and you have n coordinates of that point, and you map them to other n coordinates. And we just simply regard this vector function as an element of a Hilbert space of all vector functions. And that's exactly the metric here. So in some sense, I'm thinking of this as just the flat space. So we have this way, it is exactly this very metric that I'm taking, just the most natural one in some sense. So this way, we embedded the whole picture into kind of a flat pre-Hilbert space. It's not complete for smooth functions, but we don't care right now. I mean, it's just the L2 space. And now a theorem, by Felix Otte in the year 2000 is as follows. It turns out that if I take now the group of all diffeomorphisms and this L2 metric that I have just defined and consider this projection to the space of densities and yet another metric that I'm about to describe, it is called Wasserstein metric. Then it turns out that this is a Riemannian submersion. Okay, so let me now explain the words here. So first of all, what is a Riemannian submersion? So we have the space of all, just whenever we have just any vibration and Riemannian metric on this vibration, then since we have the natural vertical spaces and we have metric, we can define the corresponding horizontal spaces, which are just orthogonal with respect to that metric to the vertical ones. And these horizontal spaces are equipped with the metric restriction of the ambient metric to those spaces. There is a projection from those horizontal spaces to tangent spaces on the base. And this projection must be in isometry at all points. That's what Riemannian submersion is. So we have isometry of horizontal spaces to the spaces on the base. Now, what is the Wasserstein metric that is defined here? So instead of defining a metric, I will define the corresponding distance function. So Wasserstein is defined as follows. So I would like to define a distance between, for instance, mu and nu. So suppose that I have two measures with the same total mass. So I have a manifold, and one measure is mu, and another is nu. Then what I will do, I'll do the following. So suppose that I have a diffeomorphism phi, which moves one measure to the other. Then every point has its image, phi of x. So I'll take x and phi of x, take the distance on the manifold m, how far each point traveled, take the square of that and average over the manifold m. So it's an average how far each point traveled. And now I take infinum over all possible diffeomorphisms that do the job, that so that they move one density to the other. that's a distance function. It turns out that it has a Riemannian origin. Actually, it comes from a Riemannian structure on the base. So it turns out that that's exactly the main metric in optimal mass transport. We are looking for the most economical way to move one density to the other in the sense of L2. There are various modifications. One can consider LP here and so on. Now, the claim is that that's a Riemannian submersion, which tells us the following, that if I would like to construct a geodesic, the shortest way to move one mass to the other, to another, then for Riemannian submersion, it is enough to draw a horizontal geodesic in the space upstairs. And then they project geodesics to geodesic. Horizontal geodesics are projected to geodesics here, and vice versa. Geodesics from here are lifted to horizontal geodesics upstairs.
So you have some connection, you have a notion of the horizontal subspace?
Yes, of course. I mean, because I have a metric on the space, I have everything here. So I have vertical spaces, which are just fibers, tangent space to fibers. So because of that, I have horizontal subspaces. So, moreover, it turns out that geodesics here are extremely easy to describe just because I mentioned that it is actually a flat space. So geodesics are just straight lines in this space. And okay, maybe I'll just spend just one more minute here. So I claim that geodesics in the space of all diffeomorphisms are actually nothing but solutions of the Burgers equation. Solutions to Burgers. I didn't try the Burgers yet, but I will. It's easier to prove than to formulate. So how to write the corresponding geodesics? Well, geodesics, the straight lines, we know that the acceleration must be equal to zero. That's a geodesic. So it means that if I take the second derivative of a path, then it must be zero. It is, of course, dt times dt g, derivative of the derivative. But the derivative is given by this formula. So it means that it is dt of v. Which depends on t and g of tx. That's what composition of v and g is. This is just the chain rule. T appears twice here. Once, twice. So it's it means that it will be the time derivative of v plus the derivative of v with respect to x, and then the derivative of g with respect to t, which is v itself. So it means that it will be plus v times nabla of v, which is what I denoted before by this term. And it is taking the point d, g of tx. So it means that this must be equal to zero, and this is the Burgers equation. So it is just the left-hand side of the Euler equation, but consider it on the space of all diffeomorphisms rather than only on volume-preserving ones. Now recall that the Euler equation, maybe I'll just do it here. The Euler equation itself had a very similar form. The Euler equation, so another remark. The Euler equation was that the acceleration of g is minus gradient of the pressure. But look at this, it is equivalent to this, right? I mean, the left-hand side is exactly what I just obtained, and it is minus gradient of the pressure. But the gradient of the pressure, so this space consists of divergence-free condition, vector fields. So by Hodge decomposition, this consists of gradient fields, the horizontal space. So it means that acceleration is always orthogonal to the submanifold where we are. But that's the definition of the geodesic, that that acceleration is always orthogonal to the submanifold. So we proved the Arnoid theorem, that indeed the Euler equation, solution of the Euler equation are all these geodesics on the submanifold of volume preserving diffeomorphisms. That's exactly that metric. Okay, so but I claim that this picture, so you see, this picture kind of carries a lot of information. It has optimal transport on the base. It has rather simple geometry of geodesics. It is a flat space on the space of all diffeomorphisms. And it is a very intricate geometry for the Euler equation along the fibers. So somehow, if we consider just all geodesics starting like this, of course, they would peel off the submanifold. But if we exercise the force, which is the exactly the gradient of the pressure, the equation becomes already very difficult. Now, I would like to take this very picture and modify it in the following way. So I'll keep it.
In various calculus, you say what the calculus?
Well, just essentially just projections, computations of all those projections. Yeah, that's the question that I was asking myself too. But that's a very common name somehow in optimal mass transport.
Breakdown of solutions of Berger equation mean for the densities? I mean, shock formation for Bergers? What does it mean for the...
That's a good point. So, as we just discussed, to draw a geodesic on the base, I have to draw a horizontal solution of the Berger's equation, because you know that here are Berger's equations. What is horizontal geodesic? It means that I have to start with a potential initial condition, so that it would be orthogonal to the fiber. So that's why potential solutions of the Berger's equation are so important. They're actually horizontal, which kind of makes a lot of sense. Because if we would like to move one density to the other, we would like to do it by means of potential solutions, because all vector fields are split into gradient fields and volume and the divergence free. And of course, it doesn't make sense to do anything with a divergence free field, because we just lose energy and don't do anything to the mass. So it just means that we have to flow with a potential solution. And that's exactly will be the geodesic here, and it will be the shortest path, and so on. So kind of makes a lot of sense. OK, now, I would like to explain incorrect answer to this question. How to join these two approaches. And then I'll explain how to modify it. So a heuristic setting for vertex sheets. I will draw almost the same picture, but with different objects. This now will be the group of volume-preserving diffeomorphisms, mu-preserving diffeomorphisms. The base will be the space of vertex sheets. So gamma will be just a point in this space. And as we discussed, we consider vertex sheets to be just all possible hypersurfaces which can be obtained from gamma by deformations, and volume-preserving deformations. So the fiber over gamma will consist of volume-preserving diffeomorphisms which also preserve gamma. So it's such diffeomorphisms which just keep gamma, which slide gamma over itself, right? They just send gamma to itself, but they could be non-trivial on gamma itself. And the identity, of course, in this fiber. Suppose that I have another surface, another hypersurface. Then the fiber over gamma tilde will consist of all those volume-preserving diffeomorphisms that send gamma to gamma tilde. So from this point of view, it's just the same story. Now, we have a natural L2 metric here. That's exactly Arnoid's metric that I started with. Now, there exists a natural metric here. Actually, we have defined this in the beginning. Now, what is this metric? So suppose that I have a vector on the base which moves gamma from itself. Or maybe I'll just do it here. Then I'll look at the identity and consider a vector field, which is divergence free, which projects to this gamma, projects to this u. So it means that its normal component is exactly u, as we discussed. So it moves gamma exactly in this way, as it should. And now I'll take the infinum of the L2 energy here, which means that, of course, the optimal one will be the horizontal vector field, which will be exactly the, by definition, the energy of the corresponding vector field u. So in other words, the theorem, and you will see why I put it in the quotation marks, that if I take the group of volume preserving diffeomorphic fields and the L2 energy and map it to the space of all vertex sheets and the metric that I defined there, then this is a Riemannian submersion. And the proof is just definition. So that's, it was defined this way so that it would be Riemannian submersion. And then any geodesic here is just a projection of the corresponding horizontal geodesic there. And this is the Arnoid's approach. And this is exactly the theorem of Loschke and Felix Otte. So the problem is this is that only one, that this picture doesn't exist. Doesn't make sense. Why? Just because there exists no horizontal subspace here. The group of all new preserving diffeomorphic fields which preserve gamma is L2 dense in all vector fields. And because of that, there exists no horizontal subspace which will be orthogonal to that. So we have to kind of change this picture, but intuitively it gives a I think understanding why such a statement should be true. Now, how we change the picture? Well, for this one needs a completely different notion. The fiber is dense.
So it is not a continuous projection.
Yeah, it would be nice, of course, to have it. Nevertheless, I mean, but heuristically, it's I think it's a good picture to see what's going on. I mean, just why it should be true. From groups to groupoids. Okay. So what is a groupoid? So in principle, in some sense, even though I tried to convince you in the beginning that Arnoid's point of view is very universal, we were kind of hypnotized by the beauty of this picture. But one has to admit that it doesn't describe, for instance, a fluid with moving boundary. We had to, from the very beginning, assume that fluid is within the same manifold, within fixed boundaries. Otherwise, if the boundary moves, we cannot multiply the diffeomorphisms. They do not form a group. So if I have a drop of water and it moves to another one, and if this moves elsewhere, there is no way to compose the corresponding diffeomorphisms. However, one can compose such motions under the condition that the target of one of the diffeomorphisms is the source of the other. then indeed one can compose the, them together. And that's exactly what groupoid is about. So that's the notion. So groupoid, means that we have the base. In this case, the base will be all possible shapes. And we have the two maps, source and target. And there exists a composition of two diffeomorphisms, phi1 and phi2, in this order. If the source of phi2, if phi2 starts where phi1 ends. And so I will probably not go further than that. It's just kind of intuitively quite clear that now we have the object, and one can introduce the algebraoid, which means that it is the set of infinitesimal elements of groupoid. Infinitesimal elements. So one can think of this as a bundle over the base. There exists the anchor map, which projects the elements of the algebraoid to the vectors to the tangent vectors to the base. So algebraoid means that there exists a bracket on sections, and the anchor map maybe just I'll only mention that the dual space to the space of infinitesimal elements has a Poisson structure. And the examples to keep in mind are that it could be just, in some sense one can think of this way. So you have a base and you have kind of Lie algebras around them. As a matter of fact, it's more complicated than that, but and you have the bracket defined on sections over this bundle, over the base. And the simplest example is that when the fiber is a point, then all you have is just algebraic consists of sections of the tangent bundle, and the bracket will be just the classical bracket of vector fields. While the other example is just Lie algebra, when the base itself is just one point. And a general algebra, it is kind of in between. So you can assume that kind of you have a Lie algebra and the base and kind of the fiber bundle over that. Now, vector bundle. So why I brought this up? Just because now, one can define the diffeomorphism groupoid for vertex sheets. In kind of rather natural way, namely, suppose that I have a manifold and a vertex sheet inside this manifold. And now the fluid moves. Fluid is inside and outside of this hypersurface. So we actually have two different diffeomorphisms, inside and outside. So after a while, it will be a different vertex sheet. So with one diffeomorphism on one half of the complement to this hypersurface, and the other diffeomorphism here. And then, of course, one can compose in a similar way. Then, and again, it could be here, here, and you compose again, provided that this condition holds that the source of one is the target of the other. And then one can develop, you see, the point is that instead of one diffeomorphism, we consider a pair of diffeomorphisms just because we have to slide along this hypersurface, so that's not a diffeomorphism along this hypersurface. So we need some kind of quantity which would be responsible for this tangential component. Now we have just two different vector fields, inside and outside, and this takes care of that. So, so that's now the elements of groupoid. So this groupoid responsible for vertex shades will be consisting of phi plus, phi minus, gamma, and gamma tilde. So two diffeomorphisms, the hypersurface where we started and where we ended. And now with a natural multiplication. So if we have just another quadruple like this, maybe I'll just put a semicolon here, then we compose diffeomorphisms and we have another pair, gamma tilde, gamma double tilde, so we replaced altogether by the pair gamma, gamma double tilde, and the through diffeomorphism which composes them. And now the claim is, so theorem, is that the geodesics, so one can put the same machinery, one can define the Euler type equations now on the groupoid, one can define a Hamiltonian system on the dual of the corresponding algebroid, and it turns out that that system will be exactly responsible for the equations of the arbitrary motions of vertex sheets. So we consider, we obtain not only potential solutions, but all solutions in this way, but on this more complicated object. So I'll just write it that geodesics on this groupoid, actually on the source fibers, but it doesn't matter, the same as Hamiltonian flow of the L2 energy on this Poisson manifold is the same as the solutions of the Euler equation for vertex sheets, which is the following. So it will be dt of v plus minus plus the gradient of v plus minus, so on each half it will be the standard Euler equation, and this infinitesimal motions for the corresponding groupoids, so in particular it could be gradient solutions, and the pressure function is well defined even on the surface. So P plus on gamma is the same as P minus on gamma. So the horizontal geodesics would be exactly the Loschke-Otto solutions. They would correspond to potential solutions. And just final remark is that it turns out that this groupoid picture is much more general than I just described. It also allows one to describe fluids with moving boundary. It allows one to describe what's called generalized flows, maybe better seen as multi-phase fluids. So if you imagine that you have a manifold which filled simultaneously with fluids of two different phases, then the corresponding equations will be the Euler equation, but with the two equations for each of the phases, but with the condition that the each of the phases has its own density, but the sum of densities is fixed. So it's volume preserving in this generalized sense, just the sum of the densities is preserving. It turns out that, again, one can introduce the corresponding groupoid And so for instance, you can have a bubbly water. So gas and fluid will be two phases of this type. Similarly, one can consider vertex sheets that are dispersed. So relax this problem, considering that this fluid can go inside this one can go inside that one, so that the total density is constant, and so on. So there are many, many problems now which can be described by means of groupoids. So I'll just stop there.
A particular case where it is a round sphere, two-dimensional round sphere, and it is a curve, Jordan curve.
Yes, why not? Yes.
Yeah. And then the Jordan curves, smooth curves are parametrized naturally by circle diffeomorphisms after Möbius transformations. Is some kind of flow interpreted in terms of the action on the group of circle diffeomorphisms?
Yeah, we didn't think of this, but I'm afraid that our interests are different in the sense that we are interested in volume area preserving in this case, diffeomorphisms. You are more interested in conformal ones, which are kind of orthogonal, so to say. But in principle, yeah, of course, one can consider a finite dimensional. It will be kind of a finite dimensional model if you would like to just, for instance, just great circles, if you or Möbius group. But yes, that one can consider, of course, infinite dimensional version.
Circle diffeomorphisms.
So circle diffeomorphisms will be an infinite dimensional. I think it will be very interesting. Yeah, I believe it will be a very natural object to consider. Yeah, yeah, very nice. Yeah.
So your flow somehow becomes some flow on this group of circle diffeomorphisms. So what it is? What is that?
Very good question. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah.
What happens if M is a complex manifold? Then your hypersurfaces could be divisors. Can you do something in this regard?
Then they will be codimension two,
yeah,
right?
Still, yeah, but complex codimension one. So this. So I'm just curious, yeah, because you have some formalism.
I think that this formalism works indeed when you have kind of a hypersurface for vertex membranes, for instance, which are codimension two, it would not work. Essentially, there are some infinities that one has to deal with. So somehow renormalize, like binormal flows, one has to really make an ansatz in that case. So this directly would not work. But in principle, I think that, yeah, that's one can try to apply this, maybe in not in that for that particular energy, but in general, this framework. Yeah.
Okay. Well, thank you again, boys.